Wasn't that beautiful? I love that, really. When I hear that song, it just brings back all the memories of Christmases when I was a little child and singing that. So, so beautiful, so beautiful. So just wonder, are you guys ready? Yes, awesome. The other 2 hours, totally nuts. The extra sleep, I bet. You guys, we are days away. Actually, we are hours away. Has the anxiety, you know, is that bringing anything to the surface? We are hours away from that thing, that day that we have been planning for weeks and maybe months. And, you know, we have all these plans. We have all these ideas of what Christmas is going to look like. And I just wonder what happens, though, if reality does not meet expectations, because, you know, that does happen sometimes. I, you know, receive Christmas cards from friends and family, and I've seen your little precious perfect families on your little perfect cards and whatnot, and I just think that's awesome that you could do that. But let me tell you, sometimes you have this idea of what the picture is going to look like, and then there's that reality. Case in point, have you ever had this idea, like, this is what it's going to look like, sweet little child and sweet little dog, and that's what you get, right? Or maybe you're like, oh, I'll just prop up the child. This actually looks like what I look like after I eat, right? On the right. And, or, of course, this one, right? Just smile for the picture. Those aren't the only expectations that go sideways, though, sometimes, right? I mean, we have the idea of what our house is going to look like all decorated, what the table is going to look like all set, what it's going to feel like when all the family gets together and everyone's going to be so happy. But what happens when our expectations are not the reality? We are in this series, if you've been for the last few weeks, called Beyond, where we're really looking beyond ourselves. We're looking beyond the gifts, right? We're looking beyond the bubble, maybe where Jesus might ask us to go. And so today we're going to look beyond expectations. What happens if God enters into our story and it looks a little bit different? Does it raise our awareness or does it raise our anxiety? And today's message is going to be based off of just 5 words from our scripture. And if you have the expectation that there is no way Susan can preach an entire sermon on 5 words, you may be surprised. Because yes, I can. What we're going to look at is the very fact that when we set aside maybe our own expectations and we look and ask God, what is it that we should be expecting going into the Christmas story, that those expectations should raise our awareness of where God is in our story, not raise our anxiety. And we're going to look at Luke chapter 2. So if you have your Bibles, go ahead and open them. And this is actually a passage that oftentimes we will read on Christmas Eve. But I thought it was really so timely, and I wanted to use it today because this passage is really just days, maybe even hours away from the big event happening. So I thought it was so perfect for today. And the context of this passage is the Roman government has decided that they need to raise some money to build some roads and do some stuff. So they're going to tax the people. To tax the people, they need to count the people. Does it sound a little familiar? Yes, it does. So this census is going to be taken, and this is not something that happened every single year. Actually, sometimes it was every 12 years, then maybe every 5 years, but now is the time that has come where everyone has to be counted. So let's go ahead and read from Luke chapter 2. In those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration when Quirinius was governor of Syria. And all went to be registered, each to his own town. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, from the town of Nazareth, to Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed, who was with child. And while they were there, the time came for her to give birth, and she gave birth to her firstborn son, and wrapped him in swaddling cloths, and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn. So we have several people in this scripture, and we're going to look at their stories. First off, we have Joseph, right, who has to travel. Now, why does he have to travel? Well, it could be that he actually owns property in Bethlehem, and so that's what has tied him there. Obviously, that is where his family has come from. So he is going to have to go where his lineage is connected to Bethlehem. Why Mary, though? Mary didn't have property there. Mary didn't have to go. But Joseph actually just chose to take Mary because, if you remember, we talked about this a couple of weeks ago, Mary and Joseph are in this season of where they're betrothed. There's three sort of steps to getting married. There, you are engaged, where you're just promised to each other. You're betrothed, where legally you are married, but you're not living together. And then you actually get married and you can live together. So they're in this middle step here. And because Mary is pregnant, if Joseph leaves, this is opening up Mary to scandal, to ridicule. People could take this out on her. There could be backlash on Mary, and Joseph wouldn't be there to protect her. So Joseph says, you know what? I know you're 9 months pregnant, but you can do it, dear. Good job. Come on, let's go. And so they travel together. Is this ideal? No. If you've ever been 9 months pregnant, guys, just trust me on this one. This is not the time where you're just like, yeah, I really want to go for a 90-mile hike. Yes, let's do this. But it is still the best thing. Joseph doesn't do this because he has to. He does this because he loves Mary. He wants to protect her, and they're going to be together. So this probably took about 5 days to get there. She probably wasn't, you know, going super fast, so probably about 5 days to walk. They get there, and of course we know the story. What happens? There's no room. So they would have had two options of where to stay. Either stay with relatives, but probably all of those rooms are already taken, or they can stay at a commercial guest house, which it looks like that was the choice that they came up with. But there was no room in the inn. Five words, and that's the five words for our story today. But everyone in this story had expectations, sort of. So we're going to look at what happens when we have expectations for how our life is going to turn out, and maybe our reality doesn't live up to our expectations. Or worse yet, we're going to look at what happens if you have no expectations. So the first person I want us to look at is Mary. And actually, we need to all be more like Mary. We're going to learn that Mary had the right kind of expectations, entered into the story in the right way. So Mary is expecting, literally. She is expecting a child, and she is also expecting God to show up. Mary is expecting the Son of God to come through her life, that God is going to enter into where she is, what she needs, and that is going to change her life. Her expectations are actually going to raise her awareness. She is going to be looking and expecting God to be there. She believes that God is going to do an incredible thing in her life, that he is going to enter in, and this is going to be the beginning of an amazing life and an amazing call on her life. We know this because in the first chapter of Luke, we see how Mary went to go see her cousin Elizabeth when she found out she was pregnant, when she was expecting, that the angel had come to tell her what was going to happen. She goes off to tell Elizabeth, and she actually sings this beautiful song. I'm just going to share a few verses with you from Luke chapter 1. And Mary said, "My soul glorifies the Lord. My spirit rejoices in God, my Savior, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me, blessed, for the mighty one has done great things for me. Holy is his name. Mary is expecting God to do something incredible because God has made promises to her, because God has done incredible things in the past, and she believes them to be true. And so Mary believes that God is going to do this incredible thing in her. Now, I have no idea how Mary has this peace within her, because I'm telling you, if I were Mary, I would be freaking out right now. I mean, she is young. We know she's like young teens, right? She's pregnant. She's never had a kid before. Most women, even the young women who were having their children, especially their first one, they would have been surrounded by other women who had gone through it, the midwives who would have talked her through it, said, this is perfectly normal, it's okay, breathe, right? I'm right here with you, this is gonna be okay. We don't have any indication that Mary has anyone around her. So Mary is young. She is in this new season of her life. She doesn't have anybody who's done this before to walk her through it. Whatever her idea was when the angel came and said, hey, guess what? You're going to have the Son of God. This is no way what she had planned. These have got to be blown expectations for sure. And yet, she still believed that God was good and God's promises were true, and so she expected God to be part of this. Now, let me just tell you, for me, what I'm reading, if I were to put myself in this, this would be the perfect storm for me. Like, my freak out moments come when I am tired, when I am stressed out, when things are not going to plan. And so if I'm her, I have traveled 90 miles, I am 9 months pregnant, I don't have anyone around me. Like, this is a perfect storm. Do you have those perfect storms? Do you know what kind of creates those freak out moments for you? So I don't know. Mary is doing this great thing, but I'm just telling you, I'm not Mary, right? I need to learn from Mary. To be just completely transparent and honest, let me just share one of my latest freak out moments with you so you just can feel for me and pray for me. So a couple of weeks ago, I was preaching. I was super excited because I loved the message. I'd worked hard on the message, Beyond Gifts. And so it was going to be a really busy day, and I had known that because I had planned for it. And I'm like, I have all of my plans in place. I know how this is going to go. So I know that on Sunday the 8th, I am going to preach 3 services, and then I have a Sunday school party that night. And so I'm all ready for it. I know I have to have gifts. And when the invitation came out, I found out there was a competition for dessert. I went, competition? That's my word. I'm all in for this. It's a dessert competition. Yes, I can make a dessert while I'm planning for this sermon and doing all my other stuff and decorating the house and buying gifts. I can do this. I have a list. I can get it all done, right? And I'm not gonna just do any dessert, you know, that I've done before, that I know I can just whip up. No. I'm gonna resurrect a recipe I haven't done for a decade because I know my husband likes it. Oh, and it's tres leches, which means it takes 2 days to make it. I can do this. I have a plan. I have a to-do list. I'm okay. So last Sunday came, preached, lost my voice during the 9:30. That was super fun. Then I get home. I'm exhausted because Mark will tell you, you get up here, you preach 3 times, you're tired. But no. I don't have any time to sit down. I have things to do. I have a to-do list. I have a cake to finish. I have presents to wrap. I have to finish. I have to clean up the kitchen because, well, I just made a cake. You know, all this stuff. That's okay. It's fine. So time comes and things are not going to plan. Why? Because I'm tired, I'm stressed out. Family needs more time than I was planning on it. Emails were coming, text messages were coming. I had to do all this stuff. So I'm beginning to feel the anxiety. Then it's time to go. I'm grabbing the gifts, and then I can't find the cake holder. The apparently only cake holder that I have that is going to work. So I'm like, just get in the car. I'm just going to hold the cake. It's going to be fine. We have to go to a house that is a new place. We've never been there before. We're in a truck. Those of you, I love trucks, but you know what? It's like, you know, like this. So we pull it up, and I look down, and I have tres leches milk syrup on me. So I did what any good pastor would do. I put my head in my hands, and I screamed. Luckily, it was dark, so all you people who are in my Sunday school class who are pulling up the same time, maybe, well, you didn't see me, and I hope you didn't hear me, but bless my husband who's sitting next to me, and he's just like, oh, okay, I won't touch you. I'm just going to sit here until you, are you done? Are we good? Okay, I'm just saying, I'm not Mary. Please tell me I'm not the only one who ever has freak out moments. Is there anybody else who has ever been in one of those storms where you have planned everything and it's not going to plan and you're tired and you're stressed and whatever and you just go, ah! You know, anyone? Anyone? Thank you. Thank you very much. Right? Mary, though, is in this perfect place where she could have freaked out, but she didn't. She stood on the promises that God had made. She stood expecting God to come in and be part of her story, even if things weren't going to plan. She had this expectation that raised her awareness, and it's so beautiful, and I just think, oh, Lord, I want to be a little bit more like Mary. But then what about Joseph? Here's the deal. I think I'm a little bit more like Joseph, because Joseph also had an angel come and tell him what was going to happen. And I think he was like, okay, this is great. Well, let me tell you how we're going to get there. I'm going to make a list of about 25 things and we're going to go in order. And by the time we get to the end of this, then Jesus can come and it will be great. But right now he's like, oh my gosh, okay. Step one, we got to pack up everything. We've got to take this trip. We've got to go get registered. Then after we get registered, then we'll get overhead here and we'll get married. And then when we've got it all together, then Jesus can come. That will work. But I think that he was so caught up in his to-do list, he thought, oh, Bethlehem, you know what? That's just that's number three on the list. This is just a quick stop in our list. And he wasn't expecting God to enter into his list at number three. He was going to be ready for Jesus when he got to number 25. And I think sometimes I'm like Joseph. Like, I'm going to be ready for Jesus, but not yet. I'm not ready yet. I can't sit down and put my feet up and just be quiet yet. I will. But God's like, I want to enter into your life now. I want to be part of the plans. I want to be part of the to-do list. I'm right here, right now. Do you not see me? And I'm freaking out. And my anxiety is raised because I'm in the middle of the list. And he's like, I want you to see me in the middle of your list. And this is where I think that we need to learn our lesson from the children. You know, the children do not say, oh, I'm so sorry. I'm not going to get excited about that present or excited about, you know, whatever, because I have a to-do list. No. Man, you put something shiny or sparkly or whatever in front of them, they're like, just drop it. Yeah. Let's go look at that. That's exciting. Oh my gosh. They are not caught back. They just jump in spontaneous. Yes, let's do it. Friday night, night of carols. Was anyone there? Oh my gosh, that was so great. So as a worship team, as a harvest team, we had a lot of expectations for what that night was going to look like. We had worked out our plans. And then we looked at the weather app, We're like, oh, wait a minute, y'all, it's going to rain. Oh, no, now it's not going to rain. Now it's going to rain. Now it's not going to rain. Do we cancel? Do we move it? What do we do? I don't know, you know. And we were got so caught up in that eventually someone's like, you know what? Let's just have it. Let's just go. Let's just let it be what it's going to be. If it rains, whatever. If it's 12 of us, that's fine. You know, let's just sing carols. And let's just let God do what God's going to do. And so we did. And of course it didn't rain. Thank you, Lord. It was chilly, but it was so beautiful. And I had the best seat in the house because I got to see the children. There were all these little kids that came, and they weren't worried about if it was cold, if it was going to rain or whatever. They had a jingle bell. Jingle bell, jingle bell. Yes. And they saw the lights, and they were looking at the lights. And they heard the music, and they were taken in by the music. And there was this one little one. Oh, my gosh. He was so sweet. He's like this tall. He would run from his daddy, come up to the stage, and the stage was like at the perfect height, so he just had to like do that, and he was sitting, and he would just sit on the stage, and he would watch all of you. He didn't care that maybe he was supposed to be turned around watching what was on the, no, he saw that. He saw y'all with your lights. And the sound, and then Chris McLean would read a book, and then on the speaker, there was the sound of a cow. Oh, it's a cow. Wow. And you see the children, and they don't care. They didn't care that they still have things to do, or mom and dad still probably had a dirty kitchen. Whatever. The children were so excited. They were looking for Jesus. They were ready to bring Jesus no matter what. I think maybe we need to be more like the children. So there's Mary who does it right. There's Joseph who's got his nose in his to-do list and sometimes forgets to look up to see where Jesus is. And then we have another guy. He doesn't even have a name, but we tell stories about him, don't we? He's the innkeeper. He's the guy who owns the commercial guest house. We don't really know anything about him, but what is he expecting? Probably nothing more than a full house, and he's excited because basically this is his Black Friday. I mean, he is excited because he's going to have a full house. He's probably going to earn enough money to like make it through the year. This is awesome. And I know we love to say that the innkeeper is like this bad guy and he doesn't let Jesus in. But you know what? The innkeeper's not a bad guy. He's a normal guy. He's just going about his work. He's not looking for the Messiah because he's looking at his bank balance. He's not thankful for God's promises. He's thankful that Rome made some policies that was going to bring a whole bunch of people in. So it's not even that he had expectations that were blown. He didn't have expectations. The innkeeper missed the Messiah because he wasn't even expecting him. And it's not just the innkeeper. That town was full of people who had come there, who were in the hustle and bustle of life, and no one noticed. There's a Psalm 39, 6, that I think just describes our world. Surely everyone goes around like a mere phantom. In vain they rush about, heaping up wealth without knowing whose it will finally be. I think sometimes we're like the townsfolk. We're just rushing about and we miss that Jesus is right there wanting to enter into our world. Casting Crowns is a contemporary Christian band that I love, and they have a song, it's probably been out like a decade at least, called While You Were Sleeping. And it's a song about Bethlehem, about how the Savior of the world has come in and they're missing it. It's like Bethlehem, you're going to go down in history as a city with no room for its king. And I'm so afraid that that's going to be our history. I'm so afraid that that's going to be our reputation, that we're going to be a people with no room for our King, no room for the Savior who came into our world to give us exactly what we need. And there are people who aren't even expecting it, and they're missing out. But it's not just the innkeeper, and it's not just the people who gathered in Bethlehem. It was the religious leaders, the ones who should have known better, the ones who knew the promises, who knew the scriptures. They were missing it. And why? Because they had lost the wonder. They had lost the expectation. If you were here last week, you remember, Mark told the story about how the Magi came and went to King Herod and said, Herod, where's the king of the Jews to be born? And Herod's like, I don't know. Let me call some people who do know. Let me call if you read the scripture, all the teachers of the law. I thought that was interesting. And let me get all of the chief priests. And he gathers all these religious leaders, and he's like, I don't know. Where's the king of the Jews? Do you all know? Have you ever heard this? They're like, absolutely. We totally know this because we've memorized all these scriptures. We know it, and let me tell you where it is. And so they did. They laid it out, and the Magi are like, sweet, peace out, I'm going. What did the religious people know? What did they do? They knew the scriptures. They just heard that all of this that they had known for years is happening right now. Do you know what they did with this incredible news? Nothing. They go back to work. They just heard that the Savior of the world was coming into their world, their day, their time, and he's 5 miles away. And they're not willing to go 5 miles. Why? Because that story's familiar. They're used to it. They knew it. They lost the wonder. They lost the expectations. They're not even looking anymore for Jesus to come into their world. They lost it. The religious leaders wouldn't go 5 miles. Sweet little innkeeper, you had the Savior 5 feet away, and you didn't go. You weren't even looking for him. You weren't even expecting the Savior of the world to come in to your life. But he wants to. You weren't even expecting God to come and provide the very thing that you need. And yet, that is exactly what the promises are. That God wants to enter your life, and he wants to enter my life, and give us what we so desperately need. I have a friend of mine who teaches 5th grade right outside Lubbock, and he posted something on Facebook earlier this week, and so I reached out to him. I'm like, you got to tell me more about this. So he told me that he told all of his class, he's like, hey, we're going to make a Christmas wish list. I want you to tell me everything that you want for Christmas, but here's the twist. It cannot be anything material. What is it that you want? And so he posted one picture, and then he actually sent me copies of all these other lists that he couldn't post. And here are some of the things that these 5th graders said that they wanted. I really like the one who said he wants to be taller. That's still on my list too. I'm holding out hope, okay? But here are some of the other things they wanted. For Grandpa to still be with us. For people to stop ignoring me. To have friends who really care about me. I wish I wasn't ugly. For people to not talk about me behind my back. For my mom and I to get along. As I read through these lists, I saw what was at the heart of so many of these things that these 5th graders wanted. They didn't want to be lonely. They wanted to have a purpose. They wanted to feel loved. They wanted to feel important. They wanted to believe that there was hope for their life, that there was love possible, that there was peace available to them, that there was joy. They want what we want. That's why Jesus came into our world. We need to not miss it. We need to be like Mary. We need to make sure we're not so focused on our to-do list that we'll get ready for Jesus, but not yet. We can't be so familiar with the story that we lose the excitement and forget to expect Jesus around the corner in the lights, in the sounds. We need to hold on to the expectations that God wants to enter into our world today. To be like Mary, to believe that he wants to do something incredible. That maybe this Christmas is the beginning of a new life for us. That God is going to come and change our life and our world, and that everything that we want, that we're afraid to even say out loud, is possible. This Christmas, we need to celebrate that there is an unexpected Jesus who came at an unexpected time, in an unexpected place, to pay an unexpected price, to give us an unexpected gift, a gift of a new life, the gift of forgiveness, the gift of hope and love and joy and peace. So maybe we just need to lift up our heads from our lists, set aside our expectations and say, God, I want to expect you today. I want to expect you to change things. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, give us joy again. Give us wonder. Give us the expectations. Raise our awareness so that we look for you everywhere, even in the things that just don't turn out like we think they're supposed to turn out. But maybe you're just in the middle of it. Father, I pray that for each one of us, that we read the story again, that we are just in awe of it. When we hear the jingle bells and the sounds, that we are in awe again. Father, renew our hearts, renew our joy, and do something incredible in our lives. Make this Christmas the beginning of something incredible. It's in your name that we pray. Amen.